be. Like all good professionals, let the mechanics do the job and just stand and wait. But you notice he stepped off his bicycle. Now, very often amateur riders tend to stay on the bicycle, and that's not the way to do it. Mappe calling for more strength at the front. And I think, in fact, that is Johan Museeuw who's trying to orchestrate this move here. And Gianluca Bortolami, it was, in fact, who's just gone through. Chiandri, third in line. There's a lot of Italian riders up here again. And if they're not Italian by nationality, they're on Italian teams. There's Bortolami. Very crouched style of the World Cup holder. Michele Bartoli is here too, the man that won the 3 days of Tappana, and is now seen as a favourite today, and he's not going to let his tag down, I don't think. He's up here in this move as well. This is Cipollini. Those long legs of Cipollini that pack so much finishing power, providing them the right position at the end. 4 kilometres inside now to the climb number 12, the Molenberg. This is really developing now into an interesting move, and there you can see the splits off the front of the peloton. And not a very happy looking Yves Martin, I think it was, from Festina. And I'm not sure whether in fact he had a flat tyre. But now the charging out of this group here. Stefano Zanini has gone. Number 25, Zanini got third, remember, in Milan-San Remo. He's up now in the thick of the action towards a crucial stage of the Tour of Flanders. That big field of 190 starters, and looking down from the helicopter now, we're looking at probably 45 riders left in and no more. Taffy on the Molenberg, another little cobbled hill, 18%. Nasty climb, very steep but very short, only 400 metres. One the crowd always flocks to here. And on a day like today, they're enjoying it. And they're seeing an Italian set the way. He's been at the front now since kilometre 55. We are now deep in the Flanders hills. And there's no edge to this climb either. I'm afraid there's no cheating the cobbles on the Molenberg. We still have the Bellendries, the Mur de Grammont and the Bosberg to come. This is the chase group. And Fabio Baldato has made the split now, and they're not very far behind. Number 13 sitting at the back is Bortolami. Such an immensely improved rider since he went across to the Mappe team. It just shows you the strength of riding for a big team when you have the basic talent. Once he got to Mappe and the team around to help him, he's really come through as a winner and not just as a domestique. So Bortolami clearly planning on a defence of his World Cup this year. He hadn't scored any points until the mid-term last time. But the gap is not significant. There's a lot of riders still in with a chance to reach them yet.
Well, Phil, Andrea Taffy may well still be in the lead, but the race is changing over the top of the Molenberg here, because in fact Johan Museeuw, his teammate, has joined that group of riders over the top there, and it may well be the turning point of this year's Tour de Flanders. Johan Museeuw this morning looked very concerned, very nervous and concentrated about this race, the Tour of Flanders, which he said it doesn't matter being a Belgian, any race is a good one to win. At the moment he's trying to win it, he's up in the front chasing his own teammates.
Thank you very much, Paul Sherwin, who knows all about riding the Tour of Flanders, and he's right about Johan Museeuw, who's edged his way through here and never been far from the action. But Mappe have 4 men up here likely to land the final laurels, but I'm sure they'll all try to earn it for Museeuw, because he is Belgian. Yakimov going through in the white Nobel jersey there, and Johan Museeuw, a rider who knows what it's like to win this race. He did it when he was the champion of Belgium, but equally so, like last year, he knows what it's like to lose it in a photo finish, which he did to Gianni Bugno. Bortolami not overworking in the least here. Stefano Zanini also sitting near the back, and Zanini is a rider on tremendous form and must be seen as a danger man. There we have Museo now, number 15. Apparently Museo refused to look at the old video coverage of his loss last year until last night, and then he allowed himself a brief glimpse of how he was beaten in the Tour de Flanders a year ago by Bugno. And if that didn't make him angry, well, I don't know what did. Number two, Fabio Baldato, a rider who is not just a nice person, but also a rider who is coming through so well now. There's the second group. And Michele Bartoli is in the second group as well. Looking over his shoulder at the back, here's Rolf Aldag. Very fast-finishing German. Had a few successes in Australia in the winter. And digging deep to keep up with the pace is Bartoli. Fifth in Milan-San Remo, number 82. And he's already had two wins this season. Both coming not too far away on the northern coastline of Belgium at the Panna, right on the coast. An event which rarely sees an Italian winner. He won the stage and the GC, or a stage and the GC. Taffy is now being closed in on 1 minute 45. And the big challenge still to come, the Wall of Grammont. But there is certainly a proliferation of Italian riders up here today. Baldato, always recognise him with his ponytail. Robert Miller will tell you he was the first to do that. Laurent Fignon was the second. Fondriest also up here. Number 41, beaten by Laurent Jalabert in his home race, Milan-San Remo. And that will have taken a hard swallow to accept that, because in Milan-San Remo, if you're Italian, you really must win. Well, there is no organisation here. It is a scramble. Just trying to pull everybody into the same group, and really there's no working together. You're taking a chance to reach them on your own power. What is happening as a result of this, we are developing a breakaway here of absolute stars. There really is nobody who is a surprise. André Schmill, third last year for Lotto, he's here as well. And we're heading up now towards the Berendries. Museo, Ballerini, Cipollini, Fidanza, Martinelli, Piangonda, he's probably a surprise. Van Petegem also. Taffy is doing well and just shows you the quality of his performance to hold off at this sort of a breakaway, chasing him down. If anything's in his favour, this breakaway is getting a little bit too big and might become unmanageable. Still a minute 39 for Taffy, and still a diversion for the race, because the Mappe boys in this chase group know the others have to lay their cards on the table first. Somebody's taken a flyer away from here. The Berendries comes after the town of Zottegem, and we continue in the farm roads. A little bit of help required. I think we had Claudio Cipucci on the front of that group there. The great advantage for the lone leader is staying out of sight. Still a long way to go. 32 miles, 55 kilometres. And the big challenges to come, the three nasty climbs, the Berendries, the Mur de Grammont, and the Bosberg. The Bosberg itself is dead straight, kicks in the middle, and and then you can springboard to victory, the long flat road and the slight uphill finish in Leerbeke. If you ever plan to come over and watch this race, it is possible to watch the start in St. Nicholas and then ride in about an hour to the finish in Leerbeke. Well, of course, for the riders, I'm afraid they're looking at slightly more than an hour. Well, Taffy's still looking good, and there's the 50 kilometres to go banner. Race organisation just staring into the distance and waving everybody out of his way and seeing if he can see anybody. Wait for the whistle. Eddie Merckx is driving the car there, the great Eddie Merckx. Funny enough, he only managed to win this race once, which was always a big surprise. A man that seemed to win all of the classics more than once. The Milan San Remo 7 times, Liège Bastogne Liège 5 times, but indeed his big tour he only won once, but he won it well. This riding style where he keeps his hands on the centre of the bars and very relaxed indeed. There's no pressure at all on those arms, hooked onto the stem. And he's tapping out a very fast rhythm indeed. We're up around 40k an hour consistently here, 25 miles an hour. He'll be constantly given time checks. He'll know his lead is faltering. But he will also know that he has the man he would like to see in this chase group, Johan Museeuw, and the Gianluca Bortolami not far behind. I wonder if he knows Fondriest is here, though. And that Chandra requires some attention. Hand gun up for the MG Techno Gym rider, who has a British racing licence this year. He was born in Derby, in the north of England. Oh, thank you, Slada. Chiappucci. Upright position of the big sprinter. Cipanelli. And Vyacheslav Yekimov at the front, showing a sense of humour a few moments ago to our camera. He's planning his first assault on Paris-Roubaix next week. He's never ridden that great race. And Yekimov, who turned pro back in 1990 on Peter Post's Panasonic team, where he signed for a reported $500,000. And that, to a Russian, I would think, was a very big pile of money. Anyway, he's worth every penny. And Cipollini having a little word with our cameraman there, not too happy. Slowing him down on his line into the corner. Good piece of riding by the big sprinter today, to be right up here and not afraid to do his turn at the front. Well, he gets a lot of criticism. Cipollini rides half a year and the rest of it, but you know, he is a very talented rider indeed. This is a flat stretch of cobblestones for 1,600 metres, although Cipo seems to have found the flat bit. That's the advantage of being at the front. You can see where you're going, it just takes the strength to get there. There we have Taffy, and now maybe we'll get some idea if they're coming back to him. Sweet little farmlands of Flanders, and still a long empty road, but not that long now, really. They will also have spotted our helicopter hovering here, so they will know that they're pulling back Taffy at a reasonable rate. About 14 riders in this chase down. And that might be on the front page of At Last the News, the Belgian newspaper tomorrow. And Gianluca Bortolami, Yekimov flashing through, Andre Schmid, Claudio Chiappucci, nice move for Claudio to be in here. Very surprising rider, Claudio Chiappucci. One feels that this wouldn't suit him, the Tour of Flanders. He's a climber, a stage race rider, and yet He keeps on making these moves, and there's a problem on the right of the road. I think it was Bortolami looking to get away with that. I'm just about sorting it out on the cobbles. Had it been wet, I think he would have been tasting a little bit of dirt. But he was lucky. What a marvellous day for a bike race, especially the Tour de Flanders. It began back in 1913 when it was run by Paul Dumont. In fact, the Belgian riders winning this race for many, many years before it finally succumbed, apart from the victory of Henri Souttar in 1923. The Belgians won right through into modern times. The first Italian to pick it up was Fiorenzo Magni, and he did it in 1949. Yekimov seems to be the only Novell rider who's made the selection today. He would like the camera bike out of the way because he's now finding his rhythm. They do get in the way, I have to say that. Especially on these narrow roads. They're only 50 seconds away now, and they're calling this the group from Cipollini, who has decided to move back just a notch or two into the pack. Yekimov. Looking very sharp indeed this year. And that's bad luck, but that looks like a puncture to the Gavis rider. And that will be Zanini, who had a great Milan-San Remo with third place. And it's taking a while. Well, I think they said Zanoli on the screen very briefly there, but they picked the wrong one, because that is Zanini, who's had a flat tyre. Good change, and he might well get back into the action here. Stroke of luck, I think, that a teammate arrived at the same time. It looks as though it's Guido Bontempi. Well, there's a powerhouse who'll take him back up very, very quickly indeed. Let's look at the speed now of Bontempi, as Zanini chose the right time to puncture for sure. Although there's a lot of work to be done to rejoin. There's the main group. Still in hot pursuit of Andrea Tappi. A group, I think, that will make some more decisions when we get on to the Berendries and finally on to the last two climbs of the day. Yekimov keeping the pressure on. Seven victories under his belt last year. And now there's an attack going up on the outside, or is it just a general acceleration to try and reduce the size of this chase group? It looks like the Mappe boys have turned the screw a little bit tight there. But I think it's settled for a general acceleration, because Yekimov has jumped onto third wheel. It was there, Fabio Baldato, in fact. And there he is, the MG rider. 33 seconds now, it's not going to be much longer. Museo watching every move. And that's Franco Ballerini we just saw there. Franco Ballerini's up here as well. Well, clearly the strong rider is very unhappy with the size of the makeup of this group now, and they want to thin it out just a little bit. A good time to attack is just as you get Tappi in your sights. Everybody's expecting a ride up to the breakaway. If somebody goes just before, they can often slip clear. 44 kilometres left. Ballerini. Looks as though we may have a little gap going here. And Ballerini quite content to keep the pressure on all the time. Switch back up to Tappi, whose lead is inside 30 seconds. Oh, a lot more than inside 30 seconds. The two riders are reaching him. The collapse came very quickly. There are three riders now reaching Ballerini. They're reaching Tappy, rather. And Yakimov is also up here. So too is Andriy Shmyl. Baldato, Ballerini. I don't think Tappy's going to have the legs to get on board. So the feed at Zottegem, Tappy is caught after 170 kilometres of freedom. And in fact, we are hearing that Johan Museo has had a flat tyre. And it must have happened just before coming into the feed here. Nobody seems to be attacking, and this is Museo. He's coming into Zottegem. He must be about 10 or 15 seconds off the tail of the cars there. Well, there's no sign of real panic. Luckily for Museo, there's still a reasonable race to be run. There he is. He looks very, very determined today. I must say that for him. And the hooting, no doubt, is of his team car just behind. So he's going to pick his way through and rejoin the breakaway. Baldato is the rider, apparently, who is forcing the pace at the front of the breakaway. Fabio Baldato, there's the MAFE team car. No drink required. I think that's Tappy who's coming right through the breakaway. Yes, it is. So Tappy is slipping right away from the whole scene now. I wonder if Johan Museo had a chance to say anything to him as he went by. Rider racing back is Guido Bontempi of the Gavis team, and they're almost onto the tail now. They've cleared out all of the following vehicles, which won't help. But there shouldn't be too much danger here either. They'll both get back to that lead group. Museo senses it, digs deep on his reserves, because very shortly now we're going to start the last of the three climbs to come. And Museo will not welcome too much of a big effort just yet. Get some idea from this picture now just how fast they're going through the lanes here. Bortolami at the front. Picked up Museo and he's taking him through the field. Keeping a close eye on him as well. Riders that left in this lead group, and they're all more or less racing for the shot at the front, but they're not working together. Oh, there's a few more. In fact, there's six of them there. Another five of them. 15 riders then in this lead group. Andriy Shmyl is on the head of the peloton of this little breakaway. Third last year, and went on to lead the World Cup for a while. Indeed, went on to win Paris-Roubaix in grand style. This is Baldato, the rider responsible for pushing the pace since the feed in Zottegem. Baldato is one of the big improved riders. Four wins already this season for Fabio. Tour of the Mediterranean, a stage in that, a stage in the Tour of Valencia, a stage in Paris-Nice, and a stage in the 3 days of the Pana. 45 kilometres left to go. Gaining confidence all the time, Baldato. A little flashback as to how he made his move. A little bit of a shot for our motorcyclist there too, I think, as he came up on the inside. Just look at the gap that the acceleration he's put in here over the rest, and now he's gone. So he's made the first serious attack from this lead group. Turned pro in 1993, had five wins in his first pro year, and he's got himself 14 seconds on Museo's group now. And three of those five wins in his first season all came in the Tour of Italy. I suppose he will list his best result as runner-up last year in the Paris-Roubaix. He had a very, very good early season because he was sixth in this event, and he was also sixth in Milan-San Remo last year. So he's found his early season form again by the look of it, and he's riding now with the confidence you get from having success. Bortolami, Bortoli, and number six here is Chandri. Cipollini is there as well. I didn't think he was looking quite so well as he was a little bit earlier on. André Schmeling, the Lotto colours. Fondriest is here still. We haven't seen anything of Fondriest. He's been hiding in this leading group and not doing a lot at all. Franco Ballerini moving up sharply up on the inside there. Claudio Cipucci throw, and there's Ballerini gone straight through. And a quick reaction to Chandri grabbing the wheel there, I think of Bortoli. So Baldato has caused a serious reaction here, and clearly the riders fancy the chances of Fabio Baldato. And Ballerini, having made the move, would like the others to come through and set the pace. Not a bad idea, eh? André Schmeling. Ballerini slips immediately to the back. Well, I often think it's a good idea, André Schmeling on Lotto, because the team never seems to have anybody else in the leading moves. That's Chandri right up against our camera motorbike. And there's Ballerini putting in a second strong attack. Ballerini placed in so many classic races, but rarely a winner of them. He goes through so strongly that when the riders get his back wheel, he insists they come through and help him, and frankly they can't because they've just made the effort to catch him. It might make more sense to just try and ease away a little bit, because again they've marked Ballerini, and this is Baldato now looking very good indeed. Just to our left of our picture there, motorbikes at the moment, but just amongst those motorbikes I think is Ballerini. There they are. So Baldato hasn't gone, thanks to the two very strong attacks of Franco Ballerini. Riders in this group, and Johan Museeuw has made his way up here as well. Well, sooner or later something's going to go here, because there's been attack after attack, a regrouping, and then they've gone again very, very hard indeed. If they can reach Fabio Baldato, this might be the combination to succeed. 7% downhill. Museeuw is the rider who's just come onto the back of this group. Not overdoing his work rate, Museeuw. It's almost as if he's waiting for a moment, because he just did enough to get back after that puncture, used his team in the end, and now, well, having said that, he's gone to the front. A tricky little descent if it were to be wet today. Always disconcerting on the cobbles. Yeah, and that was Fondriest also leading the group back up there. Aldag, Tristan Hoffman. And it seems a general regrouping on the horizon at the moment, except for Baldato, and the chases are still just ahead. 35 kilometres to go, 225 and a half kilometres under their wheels today so far. So just over 15 miles to ride. Average speed today is still in excess of 25 miles an hour. That's a very, very rapid race. was won last year with a whisker inside 25 miles an hour. It's 24 and three quarters, actually. Well, Valdarto either feels very, very strong or he's made a big mistake here because he's gone early. 45th in the World Cup. In the world ranking points, Sorana. Very strong rider. A specialist at the single days. He's not a stage race rider yet. But he's got a chance. It's only his third season as a pro. He's certainly one of the new wave of top riders to come through from Italy. Number 95, we caught a glimpse of at the back there, was Giovanni Lombardi of Italy, rides on the Pulte team. He won the points championship in the Olympic Games in Barcelona, and the year before that I remember him being disqualified when he was an amateur in a town called Foster up in Australia, where he was disqualified for an erratic sprint. He wasn't too happy about that decision. He packed in next day. But he's gone on to be a good pro. Schmill sitting at the back of the group. Yakimov. Well, when you look at those four riders down there and you think about the careers they've had, what a lot of big races they've won between them. Michele Bartoli. Franco Ballerini, they're coming back too. So, two more riders on form have clawed their way back. Bartoli, who, as I said earlier, won the 3 days of the Panna, also finished fifth in Milan-San Remo, is now back in the thick of the action again. Right at the head of affairs with the main group here, just Baldato out front. You know, when returning, just one or two good performances, even on a bad day you can do a good ride because your morale is so high. And the gap is opening. Looks like Rob Aldag in the second wheel there, trying to do something about it, but the gap is certainly here now. Ballerini, Schmill, Moldovan. Just trying to look there to see if Museo said anything to Ballerini, but I don't think there was any words exchanged. The Mappe boys making the pace though. Berendries, climb number 13, 13%, average gradient of 7%, and just under a kilometre in height. And our motorbike is doing Bartoli a great favour here, and he's been told to leave. Now let's go back up the climb to the Berendries, and this is Fabio Baldato. Look at the lovely crowd on this climb today. Spring sunshine. And they're going to be picking out Johan Museo, because that's the rider that they would love to see win this race. And you can bet the shouts are for Johan. A very popular man indeed. Father runs a garage business. And the whole Museo family will be out, every one of them, somewhere on this course, watching him. And there's going to be an attack, and it's gone. That's Museo. And it looks as though all the shouting was rather too much for him. He's been inspired to put something special into this climb. So, Johan Museo, and he's shouting back now. He's seen the reaction has come. And it's André Schmill who went after Museo, because I would say that André is going to mark Johan. They were breakaway companions a year ago. And it seems the man to mark. After all, he's racing on home soil. Well, André isn't living too far away. He lives, in fact, in Roubaix. Well, Baldotto is doing rather well to survive all these counter moves from the back. He's absolutely flying. He's very, very confident. I think this is a rider that we're going to grow to like over the next few years. He is a superbly attacking rider. He looks good on a bike. 14 seconds, and Museo is letting his legs and his mouth do the work now. He wants more assistance. Oh, and the big man's come back as well to give him a hand. Franco Ballerini. Well, they are moving right now. There's Michele Bartoli. Schmill in the red. And they can see poor old Fabio Baldotto to the left. That's always a great feeling when you can see your quarry. We've still got the Mur de Grammont, and I think we're going to see a rip snorter up the Mur de Grammont today. That is going to be something special. Saturation TV coverage in Belgium, so everybody will know what's coming towards them on the Mur de Grammont, and everybody will pitch out of the cafes and watch them go past the door. There's Baldotto, through and over the top of this little climb. It surely now can only be a matter of time before this little group reaches them. It's a question of how many. Kifuchi's leading that second group along nicely and seems to be making good progress. The man who missed this move was Yekimov, who seemed to be doing everything right and has suddenly not made the split. Now, if the plan is for Museo to win this race, then watch out for Ballerini doing the chase down work in the group. That will give us the clue. 30 kilometres to go. Inside 20 miles to the finish. Nobody shirking the turn here. Ballerini, though, is now at the back. Schmill is at the front. But the line is working anyway. And Yekimov has fallen into that group at 30 seconds with Fondrieste. Zanini is there again after his flat. And Jesper Skibby, the Danish rider, is up into that group. He's done a good ride. I hadn't seen Jesper before. Jesper Skibby replacing his TVM teammate Tristan Hoffman in the thick of the action. Well, I think that's Museo gone again at the front. And this time he shed the wheel of Schmill. Because Schmill has not reacted, Ballerini won't. And you can see Johan going up over the hill there. Chandri hasn't picked it up. And in fact, Ballerini reacting to Schmill, who realised who attacked and missed it. That was a good move by Johan Museo because he spotted Schmill had gone to the back of the line. He might rate Schmill as his main danger. And now Andre Schmill is going to have to repair the damage. He lost for a moment his attention of the man he was marking. Well, these counterattacks are going to hurt the leader, Baldotto, for sure. Heading towards Grammont. The wall awaits. Museo. Just around the corner is Baldotto. Back down with the camera bikes. Well, Schmill has made and failed to bridge the gap there. He made a huge mistake and now he's going to have to rethink the situation. Chandri leading, Ballerini won't help, and Bartoli here as well. So it's being left to Andre Schmill now. He sensed that he's made a mistake. The man he wanted to be with has gone, and he didn't go with him. And Bartoli also, who came up to this group, I think, is feeling a little bit tired. Unless he's waiting to try and use the Mur de Grammont as a springboard. And all of the cheers for Johan Musée as they begin to line up now for the climb of the Mur de Grammont. And Johan Musée is reaching Val d'Arto. This is an inspired piece of riding by the Belgian. He has watched and waited and made sure he was always in a position. Whenever the moves went, he was always adding himself as a counterpart. But he didn't do any work. And now he's put everything into one attack as he picks up Fabio Baldato. And just in time, too, although Baldato won't think so, because they're going to face the cobble climb of the Mur de Grammont. This is the chase. That's Jesper Skibbe for TVM. In fact, this is a whole regrouping here. Jesper Skibbe has got up because Schmill is still in this group, so Skibbe has come across. New blood to the chase. Here's Claudio Chiappucci, so this group has got up to them. And in fact, when you would expect Chiappucci to feel good, he's been caught a little out of breath. Bartoli slipped back. Chandru setting the pace. Schmill going to have another little go here. He must be absolutely fuming he made that mistake. But this time I think André Schmill has done it. He's got clear. That puts three riders clear on the road now. Baldato, Musée, and now André Schmill. What a superb race this has been from this leading group of some 18 to 20 riders. They have given no quarter today. There's rarely been a lucky winner of the Tour de Flanders, and it certainly won't be a lucky winner today. They're going to have to work all of the way to the line. So Smil has managed to get away. Now, has he the strength to get up to Musée? Rather strangely, our camera's staying with a Russian rider rather than going up to a Belgian rider in the lead. There's the time gaps, 18 seconds to Schmill, half a minute to Ballerini's group. But Ballerini won't be chasing, you can bet on that. Well, 190 starters a day must be sped-eagled over many, many minutes. The pace at the front has been absolutely terrific. There's Yakimov. Skibbe, a general reforming here, the third group on the road, Fondriest, under 25 kilometres to go banner. They're all taking a drink, and somebody's trying to take a flyer. Fondriest, strangely quiet today, although he's read the move right to a degree. He hasn't really put in much of a spurt himself, though. So one has got the feeling he's always been on the defensive today, Maurizio. He knows Belgium pretty well. He used to live around here when he was riding for Peter Post's team. He never really flowered, though, till he went back home to Italy, which is often the case with the Italians. The Italians actually love their own country. Bartoli, Claudio Chiappucci, number 13 is the Bortolami. Still right up here. If he keeps this up, he's going to start scoring World Cup points earlier this year. Here we are, the MG Techno Gym versus the Mappe GB. Skibbe, he was very, very happy when TVM re-signed him last year. He was safe for another season cycling, and he's now done a good ride. Zanini also moving up there. Looks like Skibbe's trying to get some action back into this chase group. Bortolami grabbing the wheel, 25 seconds, that's all it is back to this group. And Schmill still in between. There's the devil, El Diablo. Very, very popular rider indeed. Claudio giving a little bit of pain now as Skibbe comes back up towards him. Bortolami gritting his teeth as well on Skibby's wheel. Skibbe is a very great person. He's a real clown when you meet him privately. Always joking, but he's a lot of talent too. had his stage win in the Tour de France a couple of years back, and that came after a very bad crash in Tirano Adriatico when they really thought his life was in danger. But happily, he's back racing as well, if not better than ever. And Skibby up in the main chase group here, and if he keeps this up, he's going to get a high finish when we get down to Meyerbeke. Baldato still not afraid to do his turn at the front, despite the fact that he was the one that started the move. Johan Museeuw must be thinking that this has got to be the move now. There's Bartoli. Well, Schmid is closing in, and the others are certainly not losing ground. Bortolami's group here, 26 seconds. And Bortolami is the rider at the back of the riders here. He's not going to help with the chase down. I bet he would wish, though, that it would all come together again, because he would like to be in with a chance, I think. The World Cup holder, this is round number two of the new World Cup, 1995. Inside 20 kilometres to go. And Bortolami is going to watch everybody in this group. There's Bartoli. And they're still working very, very well together, these two. Tempo high, the long legs of Baldato. Johan Museeuw knows all about success and defeat in this race. He's had 2 seconds and a win. Baldato has never made a top three finish, but he certainly had a good ride here last year, sixth. Short, sharp turns being done by the leaders to not lose the momentum now. And they're very strong turns too by Baldato. You can see the head dip then of Johan Museeuw as he grits his teeth to grab the back wheel. Quite clearly aware that Schmill is coming back, up to ninth in the World Cup world ranking points last year after his fine World Cup run. And the Mieux de Grammont and the Bosberg are not separated by much on the road. They come in quick succession, in fact. In fact, Museeuw shouted a word of encouragement then to Baldato. Sounded like Museeuw's voice. And Museeuw obviously aware that Schmill is coming up, and it's a rider he won't want to join him. He'll be a little bit afraid of André Schmill. He'll feel very proud of the way he slipped him, but he won't want him to come back. And this select group here of Bortolami and Kipucci, Skibby and Bartoli. I can just imagine Johan's family, and he would like Fabio to do some more work now. I can just imagine Johan Museeuw's family, because they keep a television set in the car so they can follow the race as well as watch it in the flesh. The rounded shoulders of Johan Museeuw as he pushes the pace through. The relaxed style of Fabio Baldato. Neither rider giving away here just how they're feeling inside. They both look so good on a bicycle, and this man is pile driving his way up towards them. André Schmill is not out of this race yet. Indeed, he's not. Now heading up to the wall of Grammont, Mieux de Gerardsbergen. Now, one of them, I would think, we'll try the other one out here just to see how strong he is. Museeuw looks as though he's going to make the running up the front. It'll turn to cobblestone very shortly. Baldato concentrating a bit further down. We've got the lone figure of André Schmill. Well, I hope our camera doesn't go too far away from these two for a little while, because I think one of them will try the other one. This is a very steep little climb, this. In fact, they don't allow the vehicles to come up this way anymore. They send them round a different direction because they can't afford the vehicles to stall on the climb. They've blocked the whole race. 500 metres of cobbles that are on them. And just look at the tempo being delivered by Johan Museeuw. Valdazzo just happy to follow at the moment. Taking a tight grip on those handlebars. Everybody knows, you see, that Schmil is chasing up behind. They're watching to see how far behind he is. But Museeuw is just keeping the pressure on, making every pedal stroke count. And there's the top. They've flown up this climb, quite literally, but no attack. Museeuw just kept the pressure on, and Baldato doesn't seem to have had any problem hanging on. A sly glance, and there's Schmil. Schmil's had a great climb up here. This has been a remarkable chase back by André Schmil, because these two have been fully expended on the rivet. And if they're going to keep that up, then I'm surprised Schmil has got this close to them. And look at this now. In fact, there was a kick here by Museeuw, and Baldato has lost a little bit. Museo's just had a look back to see what the damage is. He stayed in a low gear. Now he's slipped it up a sprocket, and he's gone. Straight through and away. And just look at the speed of Johan Museeuw as he's gone on the wall of Grammont. This cobbled little climb. And Baldato suddenly cracked completely. Chiappucci, this is the next group behind Schmil. Bartoli. Bartolami is on the right. And Jesper Skibby's on the left there at the back. Well, Schmil looked as though he was almost on there. And then all of a sudden, Johan Museeuw had gone. Well, Museeuw is gone, leaving himself still the Bosberg to come. Now, if Baldato didn't lose too much, he might get back. Let's have a look. Johan Museeuw is now free. He used to be known as a sprinter, now he's becoming a stayer. Sixth in the world at the end of the start of 1995. And Museeuw has it all to do now. He's got no one to work with. Baldato, he must have sensed, didn't have it on the climb, because that acceleration at the top was superb. The sort of acceleration you would have seen the great Eddy Merckx do in his heyday. Still no real sign of spring on the trees, but the sun is beautiful. This is Baldato, who is now a little bit confused here. He's not sure where Schmil is, and he certainly knows that Johan Museeuw has hurt him on that climb, and I don't think he can come back. But there's still that small climb of the Bosberg to come. And Schmil is going to get Baldato. If they get together, and maybe Baldato has eased back to allow Schmil to come up, if they get together, they might well get back to Museeuw, and the Belgian could be robbed of his greatest moment. This is what a Tour de Flanders should be like, a massive pursuit across the Flanders countryside with the riders living on their own resources. Good roads for the moment. Schmil is now coming up to Baldato. Something like 248 kilometres done, about 13 kilometres or so still to race. And these two are almost together. Well, you get some idea just how quick Baldato is going, because Schmil has really made a big job of clawing his way back. But he's there. So the chasers are together, and Schmil happy to go straight through. Baldato, I wonder what he's thinking now. He had his chance and he couldn't hold it. And this is the man who did the damage, Johan Museeuw. And And there's how he did it too. This is the attack that came. Tearing his bike to shreds, he realised he had a small gap. Look at the face of Baldato. He grits his teeth, nothing like as fluid in his movement there as he reacts to the attack of Johan Museo. Museo rode up those cobblestones if they weren't there. Well, Johan Museo will be 30 years of age at the end of this year, and he's got a really good career behind him already. To win the Tour of Flanders for a second time, that surely will be something special. And these, I think, are the only two who can stop him. This is the Bosberg he's just gone on to. 1,300 metres long. 12% is the maximum part of the gradient. Well, the cheers were for Hendrik Verdant on the road there, but the cheers here are certainly for a Belgian rider now. Johan Museo, the crowd watching the lone figure. This is the way every Belgian wants to win this great classic race. It's just not always possible. Last year he was seen as the winner when he came towards the finish with Gianni Bugno and Andre Schmil, and yet it wasn't to be. He was beaten in the sprint by a desperately sprinting Gianni Bugno. And this race has had more than its fair share of unusual winners as well. Jackie Durand, 4 years ago, the great Frenchman now. But there'll be nothing unusual about Johan Museo. He started as a favourite, and he's torn this field to pieces, and he's done it so well. Lower down the Bosberg. Baldato seems to be content now to follow the wheel of Schmil. It'll be an interesting sprint between these two if the chasers don't get on. Well, it looks to me now as though the lead is round about 40 seconds for Museo over the top of the Bosberg. And that should be enough. And I think driving that car was Eddy Merckx. And I'm sure Eddy will not have resisted the temptation to have wished him well there, because this is how Merckx won his Tour de Flanders. You ride the finest bike riders in the world off your wheel and you come down to Meerbeke alone. These are the other four. Skibby, Bartoli, Bortolami, Kipucci. Kipucci setting the pace at Bortolami. Skibby third place, Bartoli just at the back there. And they've got to be over a minute and a half down. Yakimov apparently is riding now with just Chiandri, and they're equally over 2.5 minutes behind, so they're not going to come back. And Fondrias too has been dropped, reportedly 3.5 to 4 minutes behind. So clearly Maurizio wasn't having a good day today. Baldato leaving all of the pacemaking to Andre Schmil. And there's the MAPEI team car now being allowed to go through, which means the gap is probably up to 1 minute. So Johan Museo is going to enjoy the next few minutes of the Tour de Flanders as he can now dream of winning it. You know, we actually sent Johan Museo one of our tapes last year, and reportedly he watched the tape only the day before this race. The idea being he wanted to see how he made mistakes against Gianni Bugno, I suppose. Well, there's no mistakes this time, because in fact he's gone clear of everybody. Turned professional back in 1988. No real indication of what a great rider he would become. He won only one race in 1988. But in the seasons 1990-91, he won a total of 22 races. ...37 seconds, so it's not quite as far as I thought. Baldato to Schmil, 37 seconds behind Museu, and Baldato doing his share again. He's recovered a little bit. Oh, Last year, he finished second, as we know, in the Tour de Flanders. He was third in Gent-Wevelgem. He won the Amstel Gold Race. He was second in the Zurich Championship. And now he's going to win the Tour de Flanders for the second time in 3 years. Two wins will be added to his two second places. Jean-Luc Vandenbroek shouting at André Schmill. And he's telling him, in fact, not to ride so hard and conserve himself for the second place. Because, in fact, he's overcooking it as far as Baldato is concerned. He's following all of the time. So it looks as though defeat has been conceded here to this rider, Johan Museeuw, who looks as strong now as he did 3 hours ago. That's what the smell of victory does for you in a big bike race like this. Johan Museeuw will sleep well tonight. Briefly held the lead in the Tour de France during the flatter stages, and lost it in the time trial as well, and he's not putting up a bad time trial here today. I once remember interviewing Johan Museeuw about where would he finish in the time trial in the Tour de France when he had the yellow jersey, last man to start, and he says, "You will not be reading about me tomorrow morning." And he was right. He lost many minutes to Miguel Indurain. But every man for his own type of race, and the Tour of Flanders today is for Johan Museeuw. He's still nudging away, look, 46 seconds now. He's going to win this by a minute. Baldato made the winning move and couldn't maintain it on the Muir. And Schmill is doing the giant turns here. It's almost as if he can sense that Baldato is slowing down whenever he goes through. He's very conscious of the fact that round about 30 seconds behind is the Kiepucci group. Ease the old back a little bit, and it's out to 50 seconds now. So Museeuw is riding to a beautiful win. The former champion of Belgium. It would have been unusual and almost unthinkable to see a Belgian rider in the colours of an Italian team a few years ago, but cycling has spread its wings so far now. And even the Belgian people accept he can ride for an Italian team if he likes, but he's still very much a Belgian person. Former teammate of André Schmill on the Lotto squad. Didn't leave Lotto on too good terms. And now, I wonder what Lotto are thinking. It's a big, big gap. Tour of Flanders gap. Well, these last few years, Edwin van Hooijdonk has been the mainstay with two victories for Belgium, and Museeuw with his previous victory. They've kept the flag flying for Belgians in this event. They've seen victories go to Moreno, Argentina, and Gianni Bugno of Italy, and Jackie Durand of France as well. They don't like losing this classic to any other country, just like the Italians don't like losing Milan-San Remo to a Frenchman, which is what's already happened this year. When you get cheers like this in your ears, you simply can't slow down, can you? Somehow, the pain seems all worthwhile. and a straight minute now. So he's continued to build. He's at 4 kilometres almost, and the two chasers are at 5. And Baldato doing his bit as well. And there's the 4 kilometres for Johan Museo. Just about 2.5 miles to the line, and he's going to enjoy it immensely. This has been a tremendous piece of riding by Museo. He may even say it's his finest victory. There's Eddie Merckx steering the car. I don't suppose you're supposed to cheer the riders in the race when you're an official, but even so, we can forgive Eddie Merckx, because he's still a great enthusiast and recognises sheer class. And I would imagine that Eddie will be the first to congratulate Johan today. This is how you should win a bike race. Outstanding as the best man in it. What a difference a year makes. A dejected loser by almost a photo finish to Gianni Bugno. And if he hadn't have been, of course, he would have won his third Tour de Flanders straight now. I don't think anybody's done that since Fiorenzo Magni of Italy did it. And that was back in the late 40s and early 50s, 1950. I think Eddie's giving him a time check there in Flemish. But it's all academic, because this man has won the Tour de Flanders in grand style. Those superb legs. And he's going to be in the last 2 kilometres in a second or two. And there's Eddie, a few words for Belgian television. And I wonder if at the moment Eddie Merckx is recounting his own victory in 1975 when he rode home ahead of Frans Verbeek and Marc de Meer. Belgium 1-2-3. That won't be the case today. Another 9 seconds added in the last kilometre. He'll be floating now. He won't be feeling a thing, Johan Museo. He's going to see the kilometre to go sign very soon. And Eddie taking part in the race himself now. He's probably just told him that 69-second margin we've just seen as well. And into Meerbeke. It'll be the right-hand turn. Well, this time last year, Museo was feeling he was the winner and had no idea that Gianni Bugno was going to put in a sprint like he did. There's the kilometre to go kite. This year he's not going to worry about whether he has a sprint or not. He's been so near in many of the world's classics. He's won some of them. Second in the Grand Prix of Frankfurt in 1991, second in the Tour de Flanders indeed in 1991. He won the Grand Prix of Zurich in that year. Third in Milan-San Remo in 1992, second in the Amstel Gold Race, the same year he won the National Belgian Championship. Then in 1993, the Tour de Flanders was his. Paris-Roubaix, he managed a fourth place. Fourth in the World Championship, then picked up Paris-Tours, finished second in the World Cup. This man has done it all. Last year, back into second place in the Tour de Flanders. A third in Gent-Wevelgem, a win in the Amstel Gold for the first time. And second in the Championship of Zurich, and now he's back. Back in the biggest fashion you can imagine, with the ride of his life, I feel. Johan Museo taking the win in the Tour de Flanders, and he's won it in the grandest of styles. He ripped them apart, he joined Baldato, he tore him away on the Mure, and now he's won by over a minute here. He's going to rest very, very easily tonight, and he'll be the outstanding favourite now for next week's Paris-Roubaix. He doesn't look as though he's been out on the bike at all today, this man. An average speed of 39.5 kilometres an hour. It's only marginally slower than last year. 39.6 it was a year ago. Now, the pace has dropped dramatically here, and this is because André Schmill is hoping to do better than last year when he finished third. Baldato is making the turn, so Schmill has got himself in the right place at least. But he's done an awful lot of work. But Schmill is creeping up on his outside. Hardly the burst of a sprinter at 100 metres to go, was it? He moved over the top of him, and Baldato has got his wheel, and now you can see a better sprint, because Baldato is going to take André Schmill right on the line. He's done just enough. Schmill will take third for the second year in succession. The sprint for fourth place. And this is Bartoli leading out. But Bartoli is not going to get it, because I think Claudio Chiappucci is going to take him on the right. And Bortolami, Chiappucci on the right will get fourth. A good sprint by Claudio. Bortolami fifth. Jesper Skibbe sixth. And Bartoli there coming in seventh place. And there's the face of the winner, Johan Museeuw. And in fact, he spotted his teammate here, Bortolami. Now let's go to Paul Sherwin.
Well, there you have it. What a fantastic result for this year's Tour of Flanders. We spoke to Johan Museeuw this morning in the start in St. Nicolas, but really, he didn't give anything away. He must have been thinking all day in the back of his mind about last year when he got beaten here on the finish line by Gianni Bugno. That's probably what pushed him over the Mur de Grammont to go for that lone victory. A superb win. He's now at the top of the leaderboard in the World Cup. Will Paris-Roubaix be next? Join us and we'll find out then.
Indeed, he is at the top of the leaderboard in the World Cup because he finished 12th in Milan-San Remo, so he will go ahead of Laurent Jalabert. So a great win for Johan Museeuw. Of the two wins, he'll count this one more than the other in the Tour of Flanders. He's also got two second places as well. He really is the Lion of Flanders of the moment. So the 261 kilometres today were covered in 6 hours, 36 minutes and 24 seconds, an average speed of 39.5 kilometres an hour. Museeuw finishing a minute 27 seconds ahead of Baldato and Schmill, 2 minutes 3 seconds ahead of Chiappucci, Bortolami, Skibbe and Bartoli, 3.25 ahead of Jechimo Sciandri, 3.28 over Ballerini, and Maurizio Fondries taking the 12th place finish today.